Wonderful. Hi, Laurence. Welcome. Wonderful. We're still waiting for Lisa, Tan, Vlad, Francois. We would love to see your faces too. Yeah, that's wonderful.
I try to sit and compose. It happened just the other day.
So we're starting in a minute. I think we're starting to be more or less complete. And while you are still like sending us like where you are greeting us from, and what does corporate social responsibility mean to you? Because our guest of today is Jean-Louis Bénard. You are the founder and CEO of Sociable, and you are not only active in Paris, but as well, you have your R&D department in Lyon. You have people working from London, New York, and Mumbai. So a truly international company, a tech company, but that is engaged in corporate social responsibility, making this possible for companies from over 80 countries, if I'm not wrong, in the world. And you have as well founded BrainSonic, who was hosting our Next Gen Enterprise Summit in October. And we had a wonderful experience with very professional people. And you have founded that company and you're still the chairman of that company. And Jean-Louis, so you have a topic which is not really tech related, but has to do with something of the next gen enterprises, which is about the evolutionary purpose, social corporate responsibility, which is part of becoming more sustainable. And what I would love to know from you first is, what is your personal purpose, Jean-Louis? What is the thing that you want to bring to the world with the companies you've created, with the skill that you bring to the world? Welcome to the Next Gen Thriving today.
Thank you, Suzanne. And hi, everybody. I'm very happy to be with you today and to share things about corporate social responsibility and employee engagement. And Suzanne, just to answer your question, it's not a very easy question, to be honest, I have the feeling that I've changed a lot on this, you know. And if I go back 27 years in the past, and probably when I started my first company, I wanted to be successful. And I wanted probably to make money, and you know, the role models at that time were people who were very successful. But now, 27 years later, it's my third company. I've left Paris. I have the chance to live in nature. You know, I'm a big fan of trail running, so I see how this is important to take care of this. And I also have the feeling that probably things that were important for me 27 years ago are maybe not so important now in the current context. So what...
There was a shift to what?
Yes, so I think that it also, this shift is also related to the different companies I've created, and we for this third one, you know, we live in a world where you are told that if you want to make a company, you have to stick to an hyper growth model. You have to raise a lot of money. You have to invest like crazy, you know, to accelerate whatever the loss. And I think I wanted to show it's possible to do something different, to build a global company with a sustainable and self-funded growth where people could be happy, and that also would help large companies to do better with their employees and with the planet. And that's also the reason why I wanted today to talk partly about my company, but in fact, more about large companies, you know, because large companies are always said to be the bad guys. They pollute a lot. They have employees who are not engaged, and even these companies don't perform well. But in fact, my conviction is that all these topics are connected, and people are not engaged maybe because they don't feel comfortable with the purpose of their company. They don't feel part of the purpose of these companies, and it's easy to criticize, but when you are in the system, you know, you see that it's very hard to get things better. And I think that all these people who work in these large companies, of course, they don't want to pollute. They would like their employees to be engaged. They would like their employees to be happy. But the system is so complex sometimes. And also, of course, you have the pressure of shareholders and so on. So it's very difficult. But at the same time, if you find very small ways, but step by step, to change things in these large companies, I think it's a very tough but also interesting challenge, and that's what makes me wake up every day, I think.
So yeah, if I get you correctly, it's about like bringing the big corporations to make them going small steps that seem for us, maybe from the next gen community, these are like too small, or it's the bad guys. Just a few moments later, we will be talking about Coca-Cola, which I honestly, it was like a trigger. It's like how can Coca-Cola be an example for the next gen enterprise? So you are like saying these humble little steps, the impact if big corporations change, they are so dearly needed, and that you're supporting them with technology to do that, to become more sustainable and to get their staff engaged in the purpose and contribute to a better world in that sense. Is that right?
Yes, and I think honestly that it's even for small companies, it's not easy because you have to combine the development of the company with your values, and sometimes it's not easy. But when you're part of large companies, you know, if we take the example of Danone, that also was said to be one, well, I would say one of the bad guys of the planet, and when you try to change this organization, it's super complicated, obviously, but I think we need to highlight these efforts so that these companies can step by step inspire other large companies. Mm-hmm. Because we can do our part being, I would say, developing small companies, but we also know that this planet will go back to where it should go also with the support of large companies, and we need to help.
So we are really curious, and I was like in the preparation, I was asking you, Jean-Louis, like, do you think that everybody knows like what we are talking about when we talk about corporate social responsibility? And you seem to say, yeah, that should be very normal. And I just realized that in the chat when I was asking, what does it mean to you? I didn't get an answer. So maybe we just start with that. And you have some slides that you've prepared. The topic today is how corporate social responsibility can foster employee engagement. And this is an initiative that should actually contribute to sustainability overall. Is that right?
Yes, and you're right. If you ask different people what they think corporate sociability is, everybody has a different definition, you know. And for by the way, for some people, it's really related to the environment. For some other people, it will be more related to inclusion. So it's also really depends on the culture of the company, the challenge it faces. So I guess that when you are a company that impacts the environment. You want to focus more on the environment. So it's a very complicated definition to find. But what I would like to show today is that we are going to see that, especially with the COVID crisis, the need for CSR is raising. At the same time, there are huge challenges in terms of employee engagement. But in fact, these two topics can be connected, and you can find solutions that can address both topics. So this is, I would say, what I would like to talk about today. But also, and this is the purpose of this workshop, I think, is also get your feedback. So we have prepared a few polls to make this as interactive as possible. And of course, don't hesitate to use the chat. Let's try to find and to have a great moment all together today. So yes, just maybe about our company, Sociable. So we work with large companies, and we try to help them turn their employees into an informed, engaged workforce. And this is the first topic. You know, many large companies have no connection with a huge part of their employees, because you have frontline workers. Large companies have frontline workers, and most of the time, these companies don't have professional email address for their frontline worker. They're even not connected, you know, really with the company. All the people who work in the plants, in the factories, in the shops are not properly connected. And we work on this topic to make sure that people are informed, engaged, aligned with the CSR initiatives of their company.
Can I ask you that for that? So you're saying that in this employee engagement, like in our community, we would talk about shared authority, self-responsibility, all the patterns that sociocracy or holacracy is talking about, or collegiale Führung. And you're saying for big corporations, the first step might be just to gather the people around corporate social responsibility and have like a topic that federates people.
Yes, but sometimes even people, the first step is just to talk to these people, because they are not talked to, you know, and they are not talked to because most of the time they have not been part of the digital transformation. You know, so people invest on licenses for people at the headquarters, but when it comes to the factories or to the shops, these people are not connected. So it's a first step. And even when you come to these people with, for example, a mobile app, and that's what we work on, sometimes these people are just saying, okay, you didn't talk to me during the last 10 years. I don't want to talk to you, you know. So you have to start, you know, a conversation between the company and the frontline workers, and step by step build the trust. And this trust we are going to see can be partly, not entirely, but partly built on shared governance around CSR. Okay, so and this is something, of course, I'm just after I'm these stats, we are going to run a poll to have your own feedback. But what we see, what we have seen during the last 12 months is that people are feeling more and more concerned about corporate purpose. Okay, and people care about CSR environment. People care about lack of diversity, and companies see that kind of employee activism is rising, and some companies take this in account properly. Some of them still ignore that, and it will be probably a big challenge for them, because great people are leaving companies just because they feel that their company don't care about CSR, about climate change, for example. And I would like maybe just to to chair this this poll so that I get your feedback, maybe as maybe leading a company or being an employee of your company. Do you feel that CSR is a hot topic? So we have prepared, Nassim, I don't know if you can share the first poll. Thank you. Thank you so much. So we have three questions for you. The first one is, do you think that CSR is a priority for your employees? The second topic is, would you say that CSR activities represent a strategic positioning for your organization? And finally, do you think that employee engagement is an important subject in your company? And we're going to see that these topics are connected, but it's interesting to get your feedback. So let's give 1 minute for people to answer.
Exactly. Let's give you 1 minute to respond before we close the poll. You can simply click for each question on yes or no. We have another 30 seconds. Not everybody has participated yet, so we would love to get your answers. We have like 24 being part of our call, and we have 10 answers yet. Another 15 seconds, please respond to the questions. So, another 2 seconds, your last hit. Perfect.
Okay, thank you very much. So the results are interesting and they're aligned with what we feel every day. People care about CSR, and maybe that's the reason why companies care about CSR. And okay, we can say, oh, it's not fully honest because the companies are care about CSR just because the employee care, but I mean, this is not the subject. In the end, what is important is that company starts caring about climate change, about lack of diversity, and I think this is something we have seen during the last 12 months. People ask themselves questions about their own purpose, and the pressure on company is much higher than 12 months ago. Mm-hmm. So something also connected to the CSR subject is the problem that we observed in many companies, and it's not related to a region because we see that in North America, in Europe or APAC. And we will ask you the question to see if you feel that also. CSR initiatives are often disconnected from employees' realities, you know, and most of the time companies invest on global subjects, but people who work in many countries and so on feel that this investment doesn't speak to them. And by the way, they don't know exactly how the investments have been decided. They don't feel part of it. The second subject we see that most of the time CSR teams are super small because, okay, companies say they are committed to CSR and so on, but in fact, the budget for running the CSR activity is not so big. So sometimes the initiatives are limited just because the people who take care of the initiative are not so many in the company. Okay. The third topic is more related to just visibility. Sometimes employees even don't know what their company does in terms of CSR investment. So, of course, most of the time they feel that their company doesn't do much. And finally, a connected problem is that at the same time, the company tries to say, okay, we do great and so on, they feel that their employees are not so connected with the company that, okay, they do their job, but most of the time they feel that, especially for frontline workers, this is something we have seen so many times, people are in fact super engaged, but they're engaged for their coworkers. They are engaged for their team, for their local team. They want to support the people who work in the same shop. But when it comes to the global company, they don't feel any purpose that would trigger some engagement at more global level. So this is something that we are going to ask you. Do you have the same feeling for these four topics?
So if we can get the second question. So please answer to, among those issues, which ones do you observe within your company? You just pick what you observe. And within your organization, do you think that employees are sufficiently involved into the CSR process and decision? And question number three, do you think the CSR initiatives led by your organization get enough exposure internally with the employees? You have 1 minute to answer. We appreciate if everybody is joining in to answer these questions. Another 20 seconds to answer. It would be super if we got some more. Yes, that is wonderful. Thanks a lot. 10 seconds to go. And here we are with the results. Yes.
So it's interesting because all the answers are connected. In fact, and that's exactly what we see. CSR initiatives are disconnected from local realities. And that's, of course, also related to the fact that employees are not part of the decision process. So they cannot feel that the company cares about their local problems. And especially when you have large organizations with multiple countries, it's very complicated for employees to feel part of this process.
It's amazing that we just got the answer of 100% of no about the involvement of employees. So we are right to the topic of what you're going to tell us, Jean-Louis.
Yes.
Like, how can we change this?
Yes, the good news is we definitely think this can be changed, and it's not so complicated to change. And this is what we are going to talk about with two very simple examples. And so just before going to the example, what we see is that a good way to change the governance is to ask people to submit ideas, you know, for CSR projects. So it's, I would say, a great way to decentralize the sourcing and the selection process. And there are many advantages to do that. The first one is that especially if you have a small CSR team, it's very complicated to source the right projects. But when you have all your employees who become kind of finders for great projects, suddenly you have many projects that come to you, and you can ask your employees not only, of course, to share a vague idea, but to structure their suggestion, maybe with a description of the project, some pictures, and so that people really feel part of it. And of course, you can suggest people to be super local, to address issues they see for the community they belong to. And of course, the one part is sourcing the right projects. The other part is, okay, how are we going to select these projects? And once again, it's interesting to activate a very transparent voting where all employees can vote for the projects they care about. Okay, so it doesn't mean, by the way, that the company will select or will suggest all the projects that have been provided by the employees, because sometimes some employees may suggest some projects that are not fully aligned with the values of the company. So it's very important that the CSR team say, okay, this project is aligned with our values or it's not aligned, and be very clear about what is expected. But once the projects have been suggested, once everybody agree that it's aligned with the values of the company, well, the best way is to ask people to vote for the project they care about, you know. So this is typically the example I'm going to give. And of course, making sure that these CSR projects get the best internal exposure. But when you include all your employees in the sourcing and in decision process, it's much easier because people feel in a way responsible. You know, they're going to be the advocates of the projects that have been selected by the company. So it's if you change the governance of your CSR, you will get much better internal exposure. And the second topic, which is not fully related, but I will also give you an example about, is okay, we see that employee engagement is a complicated topic for companies, and we are going to see that in fact you can connect employee engagement with CSR related rewards, and this is the second example I will talk about.
May I interrupt you quickly?
Because yes, of course.
A very interesting remark from Grégoire Roynard, Marie. About he in the chat, we get the message. I think it's more difficult to impulse CSR in a small company, as if employees and members are motivated. If the reality of a small company falls on everybody, could stop the motivation around CSR. So what is your opinion about this? Your reaction?
Yes, I think that of course we have in mind some large investments of large companies, and as a small company and this is something, you know, that I also feel sometimes when you initiate something related to CSR, you have the feeling that it's so small, you know, compared with the huge projects of large companies that probably people maybe will laugh about it. But honestly, I truly believe in the fact that if all small companies do small things, in the end, you have a huge impact. So I think we have to change your mind on that topic, and probably say, okay, let's target maybe small things, and I will give you small examples so that at least, okay, people can be proud of what they have achieved, what the company has achieved. And even if it's not big, you know, I think if everybody is doing a small move, and this is probably the biggest challenge related to climate change, is that people feel that their personal action, their personal commitment won't be enough. So say, okay, it's not related to me. I have no way by myself to change things. But we all know that, in fact, that's the biggest problem. You know, it's that all together we have to step by step change your habits to make this possible. And I understand that's it's a real challenge. Yeah.
I think it's not about having one person responsible for CSR. I've been working in a self-organized company with 180 employees, and how we lived sustainability or like activities was that everybody was invited to contribute, and we had like principles in the company, for instance, to say like whatever we purchase, it's local before global. So we would even buy syrup at the local market from somebody for our canteen, which was all like offered to everybody, or sustainable coffee beans. And like every employee got a half fare card in Switzerland. So, and no kilometers for the travel for business was reimbursed, nor any air flight ticket, which meant that activity of the company was restrained to Europe. But like everybody got involved in this movement by principles that were carried by all the employees and not somebody responsible for the topic. And I think that is really things that, small streams make great rivers. Yes. Theory, that's really exactly it. Yeah.
Yes. So I will take a first example, and you're right, Suzanne. It's not easy to take the example of Coca-Cola in a CSR related workshop, maybe. But that's really interesting, because and honestly, before working with Coca-Cola European Partners, so it's the European entity, I think I had the same ideas that people may have about Coca-Cola. So you have 23,000 people working at Coca-Cola Europe. And I can imagine that managing such a company, I mean, you are responsible for the 23,000 jobs of your company, and you have to manage this complexity of getting to a cleaner environment, and at the same time preserving the jobs, and it's not easy, you know, it's not easy. So it's easy to criticize, but managing this complexity is not easy. And I see, from the inside, all the efforts that are done by the Coca-Cola team. So the typical topic they had, the problem they had, is exactly the one we had described, the fact that people had the feeling that Coca-Cola was investing in large causes that didn't speak to them, you know, that were completely and so they even sometimes were not aware of what Coca-Cola does. This is something that we see so many times. You know, some companies do great efforts, but their employees even don't know what's going on. You know, say, sometimes they discover by random on the TV, or that their own company is doing great stuff. You know, and so we have worked with them. This is one of the purpose of our platform. So they have moved to a system where employees are able to suggest CSR projects that matters for them. So of course, this is not run at a global level. It's run in every country, because if you want to be relevant, you have to be local. And things that are important in Italy may not be the same in Poland or in the different countries. So Coca-Cola has run these campaigns in the different countries, with of course some gamification. It's a part of the platform to encourage people to suggest projects, but they did it very seriously, meaning that if you wanted to submit a project, you have to feel a form with very structured data, why it was important for you, the description of the project, some pictures, some additional links, and so on, to make sure that people, you know, engage themselves on these projects. And after that, they have run votes through the platform, and it's the employees who have selected. So we have started with five countries, and in these countries, it's the employees who have selected the CSR project the company has invested in. So we are, and just in 2 months, 12 local good causes have been supported by Coca-Cola, and these causes have been suggested and selected by the employees themselves.
My question is, are like Coca-Cola related internal matters as well part of the process, or just like is there like product or how they work affected by these suggestions, or is it like external Coca-Cola external causes?
So it's mostly external causes, because you have several tracks. In fact, in these companies, you have tracks that are related to external causes, and most it can be typically repairing sometimes the damages that have been done, but sometimes it's not related to that at all. It can be related to inclusion, to local problems, you know, that people face, and at the same time you have other tracks of investment that are related to the product. Okay, so typically, Coca-Cola works on bottles that can be fully recycled and not partly recycled. And on these projects, of course, the employees are involved and engaged. This is, I would say, part of the internal process, you know. And here it's more about, okay, we are investing money in external causes. And we want to give you the decision, not only the decision, but even, okay, tell us what are the projects you care about in every country locally, and select yourselves the project you want us to invest in.
Yeah. The question from Luke is, does what you described about CSR militate in favor of decentralized organization? Or is that also possible with a centralized organization?
It's a very interesting question. I think that, as you know, many large organizations are super centralized. Mm-hmm. Okay, and starting with this topic is a very good way to show that you can trust people, and they are great at. Suggesting and managing stuff that probably the company itself wouldn't be able to manage from a centralized point of view. And it's a good way to start, because it doesn't impact the core business of the company, but it shows the relevance of that. And we have some clients, for example, who have started with CSR projects with this system of suggestion and vote, and they have moved to other topics related to the core business. Say, okay, we are going to do the same. Let's ask people and suggest internal projects, innovations, and so on that the company will invest in, and let's ask people to vote for the best projects the company should invest in. So it's a good way to start from something that is not core business related, showing evidence of the success, and moving step by step to something that is more core business.
Yeah, so this is like the really first step towards distributed authority.
Yes.
For the beginners. But it's good to have that. Okay, that's great.
So the second example I would like to share with you is completely different, and so we move from one region to another one. It's in India, so it's one of our clients, which is part of Tata Group. So as you know, Tata is a super huge group with many entities. What Tata Realty has achieved is really interesting. So what we work with many of our clients, and this is something we did with Tata, is we want to align employee engagement and CSR commitment. And how we can do that? You have to find a way to reward micro engagement, micro actions with micro meaningful rewards, you know. And it's very sometimes complicated, because let's say you want to reward people for participating in I don't know, innovation suggestions or whatever. If you say, okay, thanks to your commitment and to reward your commitment, we will invest in a large project. People don't know exactly how their personal action is connected with this CSR initiative. So what we have worked on is, okay, let's find micro rewards that are still meaningful for people. And we found that trees was a super interesting way to reward people. Because when you plant a tree on the planet, and I'm not talking about forestation, but reforestation, because there is a huge difference. I won't go into details, but super specific topic. But when you plant a tree, respecting the ecosystem of where it's planted, when you do that, first, it's not so expensive. A tree, the cost of a tree that is planted is between maybe 30 cents and a few dollars. And when you do that, you not only plant a tree, but you help the economics of the places where trees are planted. So it's something that is very meaningful, because you know how much CO2 you have offset thanks to this plantation. At the same time, it's very easy to connect an action of an employee, like, okay, this employee has done something great. He or she has participated into a training. I want to reward this person with something that is meaningful. A tree is super impactful. So this is what we do with most of our customers. This is the Sociable Trees initiative. So we work with Tree Nation. I don't know if you are familiar with Tree Nation, but it's really interesting. They have about 40 reforestation projects all over the planet, so that you can again connect the people with local reforestation. You know, they don't want to reforest countries on the other side of the planet. You know, they want to have a local impact, and you can manage that. So this is something that every time we see, there is a huge boost in terms of employee engagement, because people feel rewarded, and they feel rewarded with something that is meaningful. They have the website of their own forest. You know, they can share with their friends, so that they can show the carbon they have offset thanks to their actions. And this is something that typically the CSR, the head of CSR of Tata has tested and she has seen the impact of that. So this is something that we have started deploying everywhere. So we have planting something like, I don't know, for the moment, 40,000 trees or something like that, you know, and in all regions. And we try to do the same with plastic collection. for example, because when you collect a ton of plastic, okay, you have a cost for that, okay, and this cost is not so expensive, okay, so you can in a way connect employee engagement with plastic that will be collected in poor countries, and again this plastic collection will also help people locally, the ones who collect the plastic, because they will be paid for that, and all this is really properly managed, you know, to make sure that it's well balanced for all parties.
So we have some questions in the chat before we continue. Maybe there is sure. One question from Thierry Dupay asking, having evoked external causes for Coca-Cola, what is the next step and how to have employees engaged on internal causes? What can you tell us about that?
Yes. So what is, I think it's not the problem of small companies, but for large companies, something that is sometimes sad is that when it comes to improving what the company does, large companies hire consulting companies. You know? So, and I honestly don't have anything against consulting companies. You know, they do a great job. Boston Consulting Group, Attie Kearney, and so on. All these guys do a great job, but it's sometimes very frustrating for people who work at the company, and they feel that they could have great ideas that are and they are just not listened to. And I will give you an example. And I won't be able to quote the name of the client, but I would say just a client that works in transportation. And what they did is that they ask consulting companies to suggest ideas. So it was okay. What the company should become in 5 years? Okay, that was the main topic, and to collect as many ideas possible to move the company ahead on the different topics. Can be technical ones, of course, CSR related ones, and so on. And what they did is that all the ideas of the consulting company were brought on the platform, and also local people have the ability to suggest ideas by themselves. Okay, so in a way, consulting companies and employees were side by side on the platform, and all employees have the ability to vote and to comment on the ideas that were suggested both by the consulting company and by the employees, you know. And it was so fun because sometimes, you know, you had ideas from consulting companies that, and when you read the idea, it looked great, you know, but in the comments, okay, you have all the people explaining that in the real world, it doesn't work this way, you know, sometimes because you have, I don't know, escalators and that it's just cannot be done, you know. And I think this is very interesting to have this kind of initiatives, and in a way, asking consulting companies and employees to compete, and it's very interesting because employees are super motivated. They say, okay, let's see what these guys who are paid a lot are going to bring on the table, and let's see what we can bring at the same time. So I think that this is a way, you know, to challenge everyone.
Yeah, I have been seeing companies that have switched completely to use the collective intelligence of their staff in doing open space workshops for, like, even involving the entire company. And I was able to run such things. And like big methods, like as well, Kaizen is really based on that. So I think that, yes, competing with the consultants is one, but another is really, I think the movement is clearly to use the know-how and knowledge of the people inside the company as their best consultants. by fact.
Yes, and I think it's much easier now. You know, it's much easier now because typically in this type of company, people were frontline workers. Okay, so the ideas were suggested by just pictures, you know, sometimes pictures or video, and that shared with just a few comments. It was probably much more difficult 20 years or 10 years ago. It was much complicated for frontline workers to be part of the ideas, to suggest ideas. But now it's much easier with photos and video. You can make it much easier.
We have another comment about this. Terry, he's stating, whatever the initiative, a real commitment of the highest level of the company looks as a key. Do you agree with this, even for...
Sorry, Suzanne, I'm asking you just 30 seconds. My computer is about to shut down because it's not connected. Give me 30 seconds, sorry.
So maybe I can share my thoughts about that. And I wonder what your thoughts about is are. I'm working as a coach in companies to accompany their transition. And that's really one of the things that I realize in all the work that I do is that key is the highest level of the company that has such an important part to fuel the change, to be an example, to lead by example. And I guess that Jean-Louis will share this. So I wonder like
Suzanne, can you repeat the question? Sorry.
So Thierry, he was stating, whatever the initiative, a real commitment of the highest level of the company looks as a key. What do you sign this statement to?
You know, my conviction is that the culture is something that goes both ways. You know, it's top down and bottom up. But if top down is not here, you cannot make it. And the fact that the top management is committed in terms, of course, of CSR and change governance and so on. And this is typically what we see at Danone. You know, the initiatives comes from the top, and it's not easy. What we see recently, you know, is that like many companies, Danone has faced business challenges. And the CEO, you know, he has a very small window because when he takes a decision, sometimes a tough decision for, I would say, under the pressure of the shareholders, the everything, immediately, okay, the community say, okay, so you were lying when you were saying that the company was moving to something better with the B Corp certification and so on. And sometimes what is suggested is 100 times smaller than other large companies who didn't start at all. So nobody said anything about the other large companies, but now since Danone has started this movement, you know, they are under the light and every action is analyzed, and especially you have trolls, you know, so you have so many people who are happy to show that this is not possible and say, okay, Danone has lied and they didn't say the truth, and you see that it doesn't work. So and you know, I fight as much as possible against that. You know, it's so easy to say, okay, you didn't make it and so on. And so let's try to support these decision makers who are in a very complicated situation and who try to manage, of course, their values, you know, what they believe in, at the same time managing the pressure of the shareholders, the company, and so on. It's not easy, but definitely the executives have a critical impact.
Yeah, wonderful. So that's the Reforest, the World Engagement, which Sociable is supporting, is that right?
Yes, exactly. So, you know, we make it fun and people can see how many tons of CO2 they have offset thanks to their action. They can share their forest with their friends. And the company has a kind of global forest of aggregating all the forests of the employees. So they can see how much CO2 they have offset thanks to the engagement of all their employees. But maybe, you know, I would like to just save the last moment of this workshop to maybe ask people how they would reconnect employee engagement with CSR initiatives in their own organization. Maybe, I don't know the size of the organization people work in, but I'm very, very interested, you know, in getting ideas. And to be honest, typically what we have done with the trees came from one of our customers. You know, we started doing that and said, oh, it's so great. We are going to automate it. So we have built an API between our platform and Tree Nation to trigger a request for planting your tree. But in fact, again, it comes from the field, you know. So I'm very interested in having some insights of people and ideas from you guys.
So I just put your question into the chat so that we can maybe stop the presentation, that we can see each other.
Sure.
And I invite now everybody to respond to this question of Jean-Louis. So you are intelligent people with cool ideas. If you want to share your thoughts, if you want to share your thought, you can just unmute your mic maybe and take the and comment the question. Miriam, you were writing something.
Yes, I ask, is it a good idea to share every day on the internet the benefits of CSR initiatives, for example?
Yes, I think that especially, you know, the sometimes the complexity of sharing this is that to get the attention of people, you need something that moves up, you know. So you need to find a way in your CSR investment to say, okay, how can we define steps, you know, so that people see a kind of progression of our investment. And as soon as you have found a way, that's in a way what we do with the trees or with plastic collection, okay? You can calculate the total amount of things you have done. Sometimes it's not so easy, you know, because you invest in, I don't know, building a school for people or, you know, so you can share, but you can still do things, you know, you can share pictures of the project and you know, we have, you know, I have a friend who has founded the Epic Foundation, Alexandre Mars. Who I don't know if you know about these guys, but it's very interesting because Epic Foundation is a kind of aggregator for local initiatives, mostly related to children, and they try to reinvent the way people and companies donate, you know, because it's very complicated, in fact, to offer something, you know. Sometimes you don't know how to, and for companies, it's not easy. And Epic Foundation works on the fact that when a company or when people invest on a project, they get some news, you know, they get picture, they get news about the project. And you're right, it's very important to give some visibility about the projects. It helps people remember, you know.
I know some companies that are going to their local forest. So like employees are like going, gathering from like places where they live, and they have a contest on who gathers garbage in the forest or like in nature. And they have a contest like who collects most. Or like even some of them were doing diving in the rivers to get out garbage, and they had a contest among the company. So that was not like paying somebody, but like engaging themselves.
Yes, that's a great idea.
That is something that I remember. Yeah. So we are slowly but surely coming to an end of our session. I think it's a difficult one to get like ideas quickly. Otherwise, you would have found them already, I guess. So if somebody has a cool idea for Jean-Louis on how you could reconnect employees' engagement with the topic, then let us know still in the chat. And I would like to thank all the our supporters. We have partners. It's Hola Spirit. Filipino is with us tonight, and Fabric that was making this possible that we could spend our this session with you, Jean-Louis. Thanks a lot that you have been with us, and we have heard like what you concretely do to put your purpose into practice, supporting these companies, the big ones, to do their first small steps to shared governance and for the next gen movement. Maybe your last word, Jean-Louis, if I can ask you, like if you had a magic stick and you could change something immediately, what would that be?
I think it would be helping people realizing that their own action is important. You know, their what they do at their level is super important, because, and we were talking about that, you know, sometimes people feel that what happens is far beyond their own possibilities, and that they cannot have any impact on change. And I strongly believe that all together with small steps, we can change things. So it's just having this feeling, you know, for everyone would be great.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much for being with us, Jean-Louis, and thanks as well, Victor. He was with us as well, of Sociable, your colleague. Thanks as well for supporting in the preparation for the entire team of the Next Gen. It's Luc, Nassim, Mili, Daniel, who will be writing the article about this. And now we even see Philippe. Hi. I would like to remind you that we have our next session in 1 week, and you find all the information about it on the nextgenenterprise.com. The next guest that we are welcoming next Tuesday, it's Pierre Dubuc, CEO of Open Classrooms, and the topic will be how leveraging your mission to tackle the talent challenge. So we will be talking about talents next week, and I hope that we will be meeting you all back here on the Next Gen Net. Wishing you a wonderful evening, and
thank you so much.
I was happy being you with all of you tonight.
Thank you.
Congrats, Jean-Louis.
Thanks a lot.
Bye. Thank you.
Bye.